Shush!
It's time for The Shelf. Whangarei District Libraries Radio on Beagle Radio.
Oh!
Hey, welcome to The Shelf, a podcast for Whangarei District Libraries on Beagle Radio 88.1 FM.
And also streaming around the world on beagleradio.co.nz.
Yes, and this will also be uploaded to YouTube.
Indeed, through the Whangarei District Libraries YouTube channel. So check it out. There's a few things beside this podcast. There's also a couple of interesting heritage talks delving into local history. So, yeah, go and have a look. Thanks for joining us today. My name's Glenn. I'm a proud librarian from Whangarei Libraries, and next to me is...
Andy. Yes, if you're tuning in for the first time, this is The Shelf, and I'm an outreach services librarian at Whangarei District Libraries.
And for people that haven't joined in, what is The Show all about?
Well, we discuss events in the library that pertain to us specifically, but really we talk about library resources in general. We talk about what it is we do for a living, why we do it, or why anyone would become a librarian.
Well, that's a big question for another day, but yeah, carry on.
You could write a whole book about that, yes.
And also we touch a bit on just general culture, don't we? And books, culture, films, music. We throw a little bit of everything in there.
Yes, because we are all consumers of information or of media, whether that is a book, a film, or music, because we love talking about music.
Yeah, we have to focus on the books sometimes, which we will be doing coming up today. So we've got a bit of a chat today about what we've been reading and what we've been loving. And then some songs, there's some music.
Yes, and I've got an experimental segment that we will do in just a short while.
Well, I'm excited. I haven't heard this experimental segment yet, but I'm looking forward to that. We're going to have a little bit of talk about another podcast that I've been listening to. We're going to play a little sample of that and have a chat about that. So a bunch of different stuff coming up in the next hour. And I think we're going to kick it off, are we, Andy, with what we've been reading and what we've been loving.
Definitely. So what about yourself?
Well, okay. So partly I've been reading and partly I've been watching. So about a month ago or a few weeks ago, I watched on Netflix a series called Fool Me Once. It's based on a book by well-known mystery writer, thriller writer, Harlan Coben. And my whole family got dragged into the series. It started with, I don't know if this happens in your house, but one person, well, my son and his girlfriend started watching it. It got Katie into it. And then they were three episodes in, so I had to do a quick binge to catch up. And we managed to coordinate and watch the last couple of episodes all together.
Sometimes that happens, yeah. And try to watch them all.
It was a flurry of activity over a few days because it was particularly... Every episode ended on a cliffhanger, and we totally got obsessed with this. And so we kind of all ended up binging out on it, which is both sad but fun. So it was called Fool Me Once. And a little bit about this show. It delves into the life of a former special ops military pilot called Maya Burkett. She's haunted by the violent deaths of her husband and her sister. And it weaves Maya's past, her traumatic past, and the intense present. And she's trying to figure out, really, what seems to resolve this murder of her husband. And then, as it turns out, it becomes looking into the murder of her sister. Don't want to give too much away, but very exciting series. Watch that, it was awesome. And then after that, I thought I'll set myself a challenge of reading the book because I must have issued dozens of Harlan Coben books over the years. Harlan Coben, he writes mystery novels and thrillers. He's New York Times best-selling list guy. He's one of the big ones.
Yeah.
Really popular in the library. We see heaps of his books going out.
Oh, yeah.
And a lot of his books have multiple twists and things like that. So I thought, I'm going to read this book, give it a go. So I started reading it. And it's got a, it's really well regarded. It's regarded as one of his best ones.
Okay.
Which is good to know. According to Wikipedia, anyway, the font of all information, it's regarded as one of his best ones. That was a joke.
Yeah.
okay. But I struggled reading it, partly because I've just seen the move, the series, and it was the book set in America, the series is set in England.
Mm.
Some differences in plot along the way, but generally I just felt like I was just reading the thing I've just watched. So yeah. It wasn't giving me at the start especially anything more than what the book provided. So I sort of found it really, it was like really hard work. And I did something, I don't know if you've ever done this, I basically just started skimming about halfway through and then just flicked to the end.
Yeah.
Because it wasn't really doing it for me.
Oh, okay.
But I think it was the way I did it. I think watching the series and then reading the book, I'm not going to do that again.
Yeah. Okay.
Have you ever done that before?
Like watch the show and then read the book? Probably. I'm trying.
All right, well, I'll tell you when when I have done that. The books I have done that with, and it didn't seem to matter, was Harry Potter.
Okay.
I saw a couple of movies before I started reading the books.
Right.
And they had, the books have got way more detail than
yeah.
the movies can produce. So I found that really interesting.
Actually,
Lord of the Rings was the same. I may have, you know, I reread Lord of the Rings after watching the movies. I loved the book.
I can think of a recent example.
Yeah.
I read... well, first, of course, I watched the movie Once Were Warriors.
Right.
The famous New Zealand film. And then I found the book at St. John's shop, and I read the book. I was blown away by how different they are.
Right.
So different. Almost, they could even be called by different titles.
Wow.
And I can't say I liked one more than the other, because they're just different.
Yeah,
I think you can appreciate both of them in different ways.
Yeah,
incredible book and movie.
I've never read that book. I've only seen the movie, so that's interesting. So this book was written, I suppose. You know, I can see why they wanted to adapt it, because it was kind of like every chapter ended on a bit of tension. You know, and there's not a lot of explanation around. You know, it's not a lot of description about scenery or deep character analysis, I didn't think. It's more just a fast-paced, engaging kind of plot. I think I would have enjoyed it had I just read it straight out, but I spent most of the time just comparing, I remember that, or, oh, that's that, but that's slightly different, so.
Okay.
Hmm. So that's my experience anyway. I am pleased that I've mostly read a Harlan Coben novel after all these years of issuing them to people.
Yeah, I have not. Actually, I really am not familiar with mysteries. I hardly ever read mystery novels.
Oh, really?
I read The Rivers of London. It's more of a fantasy, but it's got many mystery elements.
Yeah.
Police procedural elements. And I guess... Harry Potter at times has mystery elements too.
Yeah, I don't know if you wouldn't. That's I don't know. Definitely it's got mystery elements and solving of things.
Yeah.
The mystery sort of genre usually has almost a bit of a formula to it, I think, from what I've observed.
Yeah.
So I have read, you know, some of the big, who are the big guns, like James Patterson. Lee Child. I mean, there's a million.
Agatha Christie, for more old-fashioned examples.
Well, I love old-fashioned ones, so I really love Agatha Christie.
Okay.
That's my go-to holiday Christmas reading. I usually have a Agatha Christie. I really love the American writer Raymond Chandler.
Oh, yeah.
He's kind of one of the original hard-boiled kind of cop stories from Los Angeles, and he's cleaning up the dirty streets, that kind of guy.
Yeah.
So he's cool, but he's the language and everything, and that's really cool. I find that very cool.
Okay.
So I recommend those. Try Raymond Chandler.
Okay, definitely.
What have you been, what's your, what have you been loving?
I am 20 pages until I finish the book Hell's Angels by Hunter S. Thompson. Sadly, this book was in our library's collection, but it is lost.
Get out.
Yeah, and that's a shame, because this is a legendary novel by a legendary writer. He details the history of the motorcycle gang, the Hell's Angels, why they existed, how they rose, how it's a lot more complicated than people think it is, and their cultural significance in the 60s. The book was written in 1966, so things have changed since then, but in a way, I think that makes the book more immersive. The author was riding with the Hell's Angels when he wrote this book, and he very famously had a falling out with them, which is not a good position to be in. They beat him and left him for dead.
Oh, really?
Yes, and...
What did they have a falling out about?
Oh, I haven't found out yet. Oh, okay. But I assume it's something that he disapproved of that they did. Hunter S. Thompson was, believe it or not, a very principled man. Hunter S. Thompson also wrote the book Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas.
So we've talked about that one, you and I, before, just in passing. And so you're a fan of that book as well?
I am. The book is incredible. The movie is great. It really does justice to the book at just what a strange story that really is.
I loved that movie. That's probably up there in one of my top movies of all time.
Yeah, it's all about a journalist who goes to Las Vegas to cover a motorcycle event. And, let's just say he goes there and finds the story is a bit of a non sequitur. So he just does a lot of drugs.
Yeah. it's got the great, I don't remember it exactly, but basically the opening sequence of the book from memory is something about them. They're driving across the desert.
Yes.
When the drugs begin to take hold.
That's what he says.
And that's when they're attacked by giant swarming bats.
Yes, he believes that his car is being attacked by bats. Of course, yeah. They're in the desert. There's nothing around them.
I was so inspired by that movie that for a brief time, I got a, I don't know what you call them, like a cigarette holder.
Yeah, I guess that's the name. Yeah,
you know, the long cigarette holder. A fly swat, because in the book, in the movie anyway, he was always running around with a fly swat trying to get rid of the bats.
Yes.
And sort of like a bucket hat.
So
sunglasses probably. Anyway, I went to a party one night and completely character of Hunter S. Thompson.
Yeah.
With the mumbling. and I stayed in that character for a long time.
Yes, the author was famous for mumbling a lot, too. He had a way of talking without moving his mouth much. But what makes him very significant is that he was a journalist, but he was involved in the story. In the book I'm reading now, in The Hell's Angels, he uses the forbidden word in journalism, I.
Oh,
he is in the story. He is the narrator.
Is that what the gonzo journalism was?
That is the term.
The story?
Gonzo journalism. I'm afraid I can't talk about... the definition of that, because I just haven't looked into it in the past 20 years or so. Mm. I loved this kind of stuff when I was at uni. I haven't brushed up on my gonzo journalism lately. But what I can tell you is that in journalism, it was always... I studied journalism at uni. It was incredibly important to use reliable sources and check facts, which segues into this next segment. Mm,
that was an impressive segue.
Yes, into a segment.
Yeah, so this segment is something you've been working on.
Yes.
And tell us what you're going to be, what this is all about. I'm very curious.
Well, the following segment stems from a new hobby of mine. I've got an appreciation of nature, but lately I've been reading a lot about New Zealand nature. I like identifying plants and identifying birds when I'm in the wild. And this next segment is about snakes.
Oh, yeah. Have you found many of them in New Zealand?
I found none.
Oh, okay. That's good. I'm pleased.
Yes. My whole life, I saw two while living in Missouri.
Oh, really?
Where we do have them. And I am terrified of snakes. I like to snorkel, so the thought of seeing a sea snake while snorkeling always frightened me until I did this project here. Now I know I'm probably never going to see one, and I'm okay with that.
Okay.
So the purpose of the following segment is to just show the audience what someone can learn from using library sources, and you can use library books to kickstart a hobby. Like I said, I had books about animals, and I... studied the relevant parts of these books. And also to demonstrate the need to use credible sources, especially, I'm making air quotes, before putting information online. Also using air quotes, doing your own research is risky. Do it thoroughly. A quick Google search is not acceptable. And social media is full of nonsense, as we know. If you wish to do research, just do so carefully, but you can definitely do it if you read trustworthy books from the library. But remember, even if it's in a book, you still have to evaluate it.
So, right, so not all the books. Well, would you say all the books in the library are trustworthy?
No.
Oh, okay. Do you what's your, how do you judge that in a book?
Well, you have to see who wrote the book. Was the book written by an expert in the field, or was it written by a politician with an axe to grind? Was it published in a magazine that just looks sensational? And actually, you know, a lot of book covers are quite sensational. I used a source that I think is quite credible, and that's the Department of Conservation website. And that is something you can access at home or at the library. But the other books were really just guides to New Zealand animals. And these, to me, are quite harmless, I think. They show no malicious purposes. They're just about animals. And I'd like to make a disclaimer before I play this clip. I am not a marine biologist, nor do I claim to be an expert on New Zealand fauna. I'm just a lover of nature. So what I did was I read these passages about New Zealand sea snakes, and I wrote a book report.
Oh, wow.
Like a child.
Yeah. And,
well done. But I thoroughly checked it, and I tried to use proper citations.
Well, I tell you what, the challenge for listeners, as I will be doing, since with your book report here, Andy, we will be grading your book report, and we will come back after we hear it, shall we? And I can ask some questions about it.
Definitely.
And maybe we'll give you some sort of grade at the end.
Okay. All right, let's get into it. And now it's time for Strange Facts. There is a common misconception that there are no snakes in New Zealand. This is technically false. Sea snakes are infrequent visitors to New Zealand's waters, and sometimes they even visit New Zealand shores. They are considered native species because they arrive in New Zealand naturally after traveling on ocean currents and without human interference. Two of the species that are technically considered native to New Zealand are the yellow-bellied sea snake and the banded sea snake. Both of their habitats range from the Indian Ocean to the Pacific. Both are highly venomous. The yellow-bellied sea snake has black scales on its back and yellow on its underside, as its name suggests, and a tail like a vertical paddle. Yellow-bellied sea snakes are fully aquatic, give birth to live young, and cannot breed in New Zealand's cool waters. These snakes have reached as far south as the Cook Strait. If you see one on land in Aotearoa, it is because it is either dead or dying. The yellow-bellied sea snake is also the most widely distributed of all sea snakes worldwide. Next, we have the banded sea snake, also called the banded sea krite. One can identify banded sea snakes by the black stripes that encircle their bodies. They lay eggs on land, but also cannot breed in New Zealand's subtropical climate. They are rare visitors to New Zealand, but occasionally they swim onto Northland beaches. There are two more you may find in Aotearoa, St. Giron's sea krite and the brown-lipped sea krite. They are accidental visitors to New Zealand, preferring the warmer climates up north.
All the above species are extremely rare in New Zealand. But if you do see them, keep a distance, because they are venomous. According to the Department of Conservation, it is illegal to harm them because they are technically native. Fortunately, there is no record of anyone being bitten in New Zealand. Sources: Gill and Whitaker, 1996, New Zealand Frogs and Reptiles. Jewell, 2011, Reptiles and Amphibians of New Zealand. Department of Conservation, Sea Snakes and Crites, no date. From the Department of Conservation website, doc.govt.nz. You can access the above sources at Whangarei District Libraries. Thank you for listening.
Well, that was Andy with his report on snakes in New Zealand. And well, the first thing I have learned is that there are quite potentially snakes in New Zealand, if you count the water. I hadn't thought of it from that point of view.
Yes, and the one of the limitations of the report I did was that I saw a map on the DOC website that showed the locations of where they have been spotted. But the map wasn't labeled, because I do not know every little strait or...
But mostly North Island.
North Island.
They've drifted down in the warm currents, is what you're saying?
Yeah, they drift, and they're not common. So if you're swimming and you're afraid, just remember how rare they actually are.
Yeah. Interesting, though. Yeah. So obviously you do get sightings from time to time.
Yes. And another of the limitations of this is that I actually wanted to get a source written within the past year in book form. The DOC website is listed as no date, most likely because it is just updated constantly. Mm-hmm. And that's fine. That's quite good. But I was hoping to have one in book form.
I heard one of your books was from 1966.
96.
96.
Okay. Yeah.
Oh, that's not quite so bad. But I was thinking, yeah, things may have changed.
And also maybe I'm hoping my pronunciation for Saint Giron was correct, and Sea Crites. It's spelled looks like crate. But
okay.
Yeah, well, I hope I was correct. I do have something I wrote here called the Dunning-Kruger effect, and I feel that this is something that occurs to people who do just a little bit of reading about a topic and then assuming they're an expert.
Yeah, like you.
And
that's a joke.
Yeah. So the definition of the Dunning-Kruger effect is, in psychology, a cognitive bias whereby people with limited knowledge or competence in a given intellectual or social domain greatly overestimate their own knowledge or competence in that domain relative to objective criteria or to the performance of their peers or of people in general. So if you read an article in a magazine or even an encyclopedia about a disease, you do not have the same knowledge of that disease as a doctor, for example.
No, so I think we'd probably all... Would you agree the Dunning-Kruger effect is alive and well in the world today?
Oh, yes.
Especially maybe if you dipped into social media. But actually, if you just talk to... I'm sure I'm guilty of the Dunning-Kruger effect.
I think we all are, and I have learned quite a lot about sea snakes, I only know what I have just read, and I read enough to talk about it for 3 minutes and 25 seconds.
Mm.
Yeah.
Well, it was very good. So I'm sure you at home listening are thinking, what are we going to grade Andy for his report? And as well as mentioning the Dunning-Kruger effect, I think you had a lot of good other effects on there. Lots of special effects, which was new to the shelf. It's going next level.
I did have fun with those.
Yeah, that was good. I enjoyed the special effects. So I see no reason not to give you an A+ on that one.
Oh, why, yeah. Thank you.
You're welcome. Yeah, if you disagree, feel free to post a comment on our YouTube channel.
Sure, yeah.
Or send us a message to the library or come and tell us you disagree, and we can downgrade Andy quite happily.
Oh.
Yeah. Yeah, well, That was cool. Thank you.
Oh, you're welcome.
That was very interesting. And what have we got next? We've got a song.
We do. And I have a song that I'd like to play because I also discovered this artist from a library. I was reading an article in the New Yorker, how Odetta Revolutionized. I'll just start over. It's from the New Yorker. The title is How Odetta Revolutionized Folk Music. And, of course, I went to YouTube and I listened to her music, and I've got a new favorite song in the queue.
Cool.
So let's play it.
What, can you tell me it's an old song, isn't it?
Yes, maybe I should know. I think it is from the 60s, yep. Perhaps even the late 50s.
But well, we could fact check that while we were listening to it and find out a bit more about Odetta.
Yeah, so this song is Hit or Miss.
Everybody say, be everybody else, can't you see? You gotta be the... Ain't nobody just like you, you gotta be you. Baby, hit or miss.
You're back listening to The Shelf, Whangarei Libraries District Radio Show on Beagle Radio, 88.1 FM. And that was Odetta with a song called I Gotta Be Me. That was a banger. Loved it.
Hit or miss.
Oh, yeah, definitely a hit.
That's... Oh, I mean, the song's called Hit or Miss.
Oh, was it?
Yeah. Well,
Well, hey, you sure?
I wrote it wrong in the script.
Oh, okay. Well, you wrote it down.
But you've
downgraded from an A+ to an A already.
What a fun song, though.
That's a great song. Yeah. I was just saying to you that I wasn't expecting it to be kind of funky like that.
Yeah, yeah.
So I'd heard of Odetta, but I don't think I've ever listened to Odetta. I remember, she got a mention in Bob Dylan's autobiography, which is called Chronicles, Volume 2. I recommend that for a good autobiography of a musician. But I'm just reading online that she was born 1930. She was a key figure of the civil rights movement, but was also an influence in the whole folk music revival and influenced people like Bob Dylan, Joan Baez, Janis Joplin. So, yeah.
Okay.
Good choice.
Yeah.
So The Hit or Miss was a hit.
It was a hit, yes.
All right, what are we going to do now? Are we going to do some sort of quiz? This looks fun.
Yes, I have a quiz for you, Glenn. I'm going to test your literary knowledge. Do I have a jingle for this? I think I do.
All right, yeah.
And that was it. A harp glissando.
Oh, play it again? I didn't hear it.
I'll play it again. Yeah, that was very quiet, but that's okay.
Oh, cool. Yeah, well, thank you. We've got a sting for that, too. That's great. So you're quizzing me, but you're also quizzing the people listening.
Yes, I am. So to our listeners, feel free to shout out the answers, especially if you are in public and wearing headphones. Just shout out the answers.
Yeah.
Look like a maniac.
Please.
Yeah, please do.
Do it for us. and this is the chance where you are going to discover how illiterate I am. I'm not looking forward to this. While quietly looking forward to it.
Well, I'm starting with some easier ones.
So that's what you say, but let's see how it goes. Come on.
All right. Robert Galbraith is the pen name for which famous author?
Oh, yeah. Harry Potter author Rowling, J.K. Rowling.
That's right, yes. Okay.
Thank you. That was a good easy one for me. Thank you.
Now let's go a bit deeper. Children's author An Do comes from which country? Is it South Korea? Mm-hmm. Vietnam, Japan, or China?
Do I get to find a friend?
No.
Okay.
Nope, you have to trust your wits.
Yeah, all right. This is a guess. This is a guess, Andy. I'm going to go Vietnam.
That is correct. Right. Although An Do is an Australian author.
I thought An Do was Australian, so you didn't give me that choice. But what, they come from Vietnam but live in Australia.
Yeah. Yeah, originally Ho Chi Minh City, and An Do wrote Hot Dog.
Big popular in the children's room.
Oh, yeah, yeah. You always see the name An Do in large print.
A-H-N.
That's right.
Yeah. Last name, D-O.
I apologize if I did not pronounce that correctly. Okay, next. I'm going to read the first few lines of a poem, and you have to tell me what poem it is.
Okay.
I met a traveler from an antique land who said, two vast and trunkless legs of stone stand in the desert. So what poem is this from? Is it A, Manhattan, B, Rorschach, C, Ozymandias, or D, Night Owl?
Yeah, I'm relying on wits and guesswork here. I'm thinking either C or D.
Okay.
Let's go with C.
That is correct. Ozymandias.
And what's Ozymandias all about and who wrote that?
Percy Bysshe Shelley wrote Ozymandias. The gist of the poem, I read it on the radio once, is there's this statue in the desert that's just a ruin, and there's a plaque below it that says something like, I am Ozymandias, king of kings, ruler of worlds. Behold my wrath, ye mighty in despair.
Okay.
Yeah, and around it, there's absolutely nothing.
Nothing.
Yep.
sounds like a Gary Larson Far Side
cartoon. It does. And my options, Manhattan, Rorschach, Ozymandias, and Night Owl are all characters from The Watchmen.
I've been playing this game, Connections, on my phone. I don't know if you do that. It's online. You've got a grid of 16 things. There's four lines of four things that...
Okay.
Four groups of four connections to spot.
Yeah.
So if when you know something, it's really obvious. Oh, hang on. You know, I can see what you've done there. But Yeah, if you can't see the connections, it's hard.
Oh, okay.
If you don't have that prior knowledge.
That's another recommendation of mine. The Watchman is an amazing book. And the poem Ozymandias is also great, if you find it in the library.
Hey, well, I think, have I got everything right so far?
Yes, you have.
I mean, that's surprising, but yeah. Okay, well, this has suddenly become fun.
Okay. Only recently has it become fun. So I'm going to read a quote from a novel, and you have to tell me what novel it is from.
Okay.
The only people for me are the mad ones, the ones who are mad to live, mad to talk, mad to be saved, desirous of everything at the same time, the ones who never yawn or say a commonplace thing, but burn, burn, burn like fabulous yellow Roman candles exploding like spiders across the stars, and in the middle you see the blue center light pop and everything goes, aww.
Okay. Have I got a multi-choice or do I just have to guess out?
It's multiple choice.
Okay, good.
So the above quote is from On the Road, Naked Lunch, Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas, or The Electric Kool-Aid Acid Test.
Oh, no, this is too hard now. Could be any one of those.
Some countercultural questions and books, I mean.
So we had On the Road, The Kool-Aid Test. What were the other two options?
Naked Lunch and Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas.
I'm going to go Fear and Loathing.
It is from On the Road by Jack Kerouac.
Yeah.
I'm listening to the audiobook now. It's my third reading. I read it at uni. I read it as a man in my 20s, and now I'm listening to it again. Your perspective of this book can change as you age.
It's been a long time since I read that.
Yeah.
Are you enjoying it?
Yeah, I am. I think an audiobook's a different experience. Sometimes you're concentrating on the road. And
so you're listening to On the Road while on the
road. Yeah, exactly. And really, I am enjoying it. I've got a new way of looking at it now that I'm a little older. But the way I saw it when I was 19 when I read it, I just thought it was the coolest thing I'd ever read. and yes, some listeners have noticed. I've so far mentioned Hell's Angels. I've mentioned Fear and Loathing and now On the Road. Yes, they're all a similar literary movement.
Mm-hmm.
And these other books here, Naked Lunch, Fear and Loathing, and The Electric Kool-Aid Acid Test, are all great books. I would recommend all of them. So,
Hey, well, these great books that you've... that was a good quiz. One from five, I think. Four from five, only one wrong. That's not too bad.
Three out of four. Yeah,
three out of four.
You got a 75%.
Well, that's good.
That's an average score, yes.
Hopefully you all got them if you're listening.
Yes.
Now, books. We were talking about books. Now, LJ, who's also part of this fortnightly library radio show, has set the challenge to themselves of choosing book-related songs. So I went into my cupboard and got out quite possibly the last CD I ever purchased from a store. I remember purchasing this from... years ago, 2005 or 6, it's by a group called The Books. They're a duo, actually. And they, I don't know, it's kind of electronica. They heavily use samples.
Okay.
And I bought it because it was regarded as one of the good albums of the year by someone or other. It's kind of like ambient.
Okay.
It's not real obvious songs in it. This one, I've got some notes here. I've got to grab them. It's got a. Not only are they called The Books, but this particular track we're going to play contains a literary sample, which I can't remember what it is. I'll tell you after. This song is by The Books. It's called "Good to Them Always." So let's see if the CD player works. So far, no.
I think you...
Hang on. I see what we've done here. I see what
a different channel.
It would help if we had the right channel. Do you want to fade up that channel, Andy?
It's MP3. This one?
All right. So this, hopefully, is The Books.
I can...
we are. Here we are. We are anticipating. There it is. There it is.
Here we are, and there it is.
Here we are.
That was The Books, and it wasn't the track I tried to play. I managed to mess up the CD player, but never mind. That was a track called A Little Longing Goes Away from their album called Lost and Safe from 2005. Right, what's up now, Andy?
We're going to roast the classics.
Well, this has been, I've never been involved with this segment before, but this has been my one of my favorite things to listen to over the last few shelf shows. So I'm looking forward to this.
Yeah, so what it means, when we roast the classics, we read bad reviews from Amazon and Goodreads or anywhere else where we can find them. And the book that we chose was Catcher in the Rye by J.D. Salinger.
Well, how many times have you read this one?
Just once.
Yeah, me too. Long time ago.
Yeah, and, you know, I disagree with a lot of these. I liked the book. If you haven't read Catcher in the Rye, it's about a very troubled youth who's been kicked out of his elite school, and he's just meandering in New York City. And he's about 14 or 15, and he's a very troubled boy.
Mm. I thought it was a great book. But anyway, let's read out what these folk think.
And some of these reviews sound like they were written by the protagonist of the book. His name is Holden Caulfield.
That's right.
He calls people phonies who he doesn't like. Well, let's get into it.
Okay.
Shall I do the first?
You go first, yeah.
I'm not an action junkie, but I waited for something to happen. Nothing did. I know I'm in the minority, but I did not like this book.
Well, that's okay. All right, here we go. This one says, I can't see what's so impressive about a kid who can't figure out what he wants and so wastes his potential. Surely there's got to be more than moaning about being phony when you're a phony.
Terrible book. Probably a government psyop.
What's a psyop? Secret operation?
Psychological operation.
Oh, okay.
I don't know. I don't know about that one.
Oh, that's good.
But, well, you know, maybe they're
sounds
right.
Nice.
Maybe they're right.
Maybe. I'm sure the government wrote a book, yeah. Let's also not forget the story that was as awful as the protagonist. Well, the plot is, oh, wait, OMG, I lost the plot. Or was it even there? Seriously, though, what is the plot? All that really happened in the book is Holden swearing, drinking, dancing, and the cycle repeats. I bought a book to read about someone drinking and dancing? Honestly?
I don't remember him dancing in the book. It's been a while. Basically, it's a spoiled kid whining about how he hates everyone and everything and that everyone except him is a phony. Even the encounter with the pimp and prostitute does nothing to enliven the dull read that is this book. Basically, read the first three chapters, the prostitute chapter, and the last three chapters. And you'll have the gist of the book. Everything else is just the same thing repeated over and over.
Well, I've got one of the shortest reviews here. Dribble.
Dribble? I think he means drivel.
I think so, yeah.
Well, these are unedited reviews. The protagonist, Holden Caulfield, went to see a movie. He kept griping at how horrible it was. Then decided to use up a page and a half describing the movie in detail. Maybe that's how the author came to write this book. Who knows? 100% guaranteed some psychological persuasive marketing scams were used to promote this book. Absolutely terrible.
What year was this book? It was 50s, 60s?
I think late 40s, maybe.
Okay.
Yeah.
I don't know. Had we discovered persuasive psychological marketing scams in the 40s?
I don't know.
I don't know.
Yeah, I think that's a modern take.
Yeah, definitely.
This one's in all caps.
This one's all caps. I'll go back to this one from the microphone. We get it. Everyone around you is a phony and you're the only genuine person to exist. You're so awesome and special. We all wish we were just like you, you rich, insufferable SOB.
This next one's my favorite. Americans are weird. What's so special about this book? That's it.
Yeah. If I ever hear the word phony again, everyone around me should be concerned for their safety. I hate you, J.D. Salander. Just the mention of your double stupid initial name fills me to the brim with unbridled hatred.
I think Holden Caulfield himself wrote this one. Literary people are just a bunch of phonies who think something is good and tell people it's good when really it isn't. They kill me. They really do. Yeah, that. And that, those are the unpopular opinions about Catcher in the Rye by J.D. Salinger.
I enjoyed that.
I did too.
I enjoyed it, yeah.
Americans are weird.
All of the
weird.
Views expressed here are not necessarily our views or something. Yeah, that's our disclaimer.
I liked the book.
Yeah, it was good. It's got a definite vibe, doesn't it, the book?
Oh, definitely.
That's the whole point.
Yeah.
All right. I think we'll dive away to a song now while we set up the next segment, if that's all right with
yes.
you, Andy.
Yes, it is.
So this, while I was digging around to find my CD by the books, I came across this CD I got by the band Os Mutantes. They're a Brazilian group. They were an important group in Brazil in the 1960s through to about 1980. They were around.
Okay.
They, a whole lot of kind of, what's the word I'm looking for? Psychedelic rock.
Okay.
And the reason I thought I should play a song off it is the first track is Don Quixote,
yeah,
which is a book, right?
Yeah.
Don Quixote.
Don
so
Quixote.
Turns out in the liner notes of the CD, the translation of Don Quixote is Don Quixote.
Yeah.
It must be the Portuguese. So it's not my favorite track off this album, but we'll give it a whirl because it's the literary one.
Yep.
All right. So let's see how this sounds. This is Os Mutantes with Don Quixote.
Chupando chiclete. O Sancho tem chance e a chance. O chicote é o vento e a morte mascando o Quixote. Chicote no Sancho, moinho sem vinho. Não corra, me puxe, meu vinho, meu crush. Que triste caminho sem Sancho, Quixote. Sua chance, chicote, sua vida na morte. O Sancho tem chance e a chance, o chicote é o vento e a morte mascando o Quixote. Chicote no Sancho, moinho sem vinho, não corra, me puxe, não vinho, me puxe. E desse caminho, sem Sancho, Quixote, sua chance, chicote, sua vida na morte. We'll be right back.
was Os Mutantes with the track called Don Quixote. And a little bit of info about them. They were formed 1966 in Brazil. They did a bunch of albums, I think, up until about the late 70s. They released two albums in the late 60s, heavily influenced by Tropicália, which blended psychedelic rock with other art forms. And during this period, they were threatened by the military government of Brazil at that time.
Oh.
So there you go. They're kind of, I don't know, involved a whole bunch of stuff. Amazingly, they have been quite championed by other people. Kurt Cobain publicly requested a reunion tour.
Oh, wow.
93.
Okay.
So, yeah, they were a big influence in Brazilian rock. Pretty crazy. Weirdly good.
Yeah. Yeah, the intro reminded me of a, I don't know, watching a movie from the 30s. The Overture starts.
Yeah. Yeah. Interesting. All right. Well, I thought we'd switch over now to talk about... Oh, we're nearly out of time. We better do this quickly. This is a little excerpt from a podcast called Plungecast, which is put together by Aru Singh. He's a local Whangarei comic enthusiast, comic maker, and he organises the Plunge Comic Convention, which the library's attended a number of times. He's got a lot of podcasts on his YouTube channel. And there's one podcast last week that they had a great chat about comics and how we sometimes make badges out of old comics that we're discarding. And this, they were having a chat with a guy called Stu Coulson, who is an Auckland comic guy. I think he has a shop in Auckland. And they ended up having a really great chat about encouraging children to read. And so that's why I'd like to play this today. So without further ado, let's have a listen. And if we've got time, we can have a quick chat about it.
You can help them. Yeah.
A badge that the kid has made with Batman and Robin on it that they wear for the next 6 months is possibly going to do more to get that kid to want to read Batman than at an age that they're not ready for it, or a graphic novel that doesn't interest them, that doesn't quite have their level. Is, you know, so if you're using that comic in that way, totally, that's probably going to have them more interested in. And, you know, one of the things that we have libraries, one of the reasons we got involved with them a lot is I remember one librarian coming to me and saying, Stuart, we've got 15-year-old boys here that surf the internet by symbols. They're not even reading, you know, they see a Nike swoosh and they click on it from that way. They've never read anything for pleasure in their entire life. So it started off at school with this is how to read, and now here's the prescribed book that you have to read to understand, you know, that you know what you're doing in reading. And they've, you know, I even remember my daughter when she was, I think she was about 7 or 8, and it was school, you know, it was the school holidays, and I was like, hey, do you want to go up to the library, to Tauranga, to see if we can find some books that you might want to look at, because we had them at home. So she liked books, but the idea of her impression of the library, she just says, no way, it's just full of old people that yell at you. So her school librarian was just this grumpy old woman. And I think this is my passion project about comics, and why I do a lot more of the community-based stuff, and why I love the idea of cutting up comics and making badges out of it, is getting kids to read for pleasure, so they read as an adult for pleasure. Too many, you know, when we get people in and they're looking to get something for their kid, and I'm like, is there something you want? And they go, I don't read. How do adults say that? And how do they say it with pride? How do you like, no, I don't read, man? Like, bro, that's not something you want to advertise. That's keep that on the down low, man. I mean, it's cool that you're here to help your kid out. Maybe you'd like me to help you, because if that's where you're at, maybe, you know, that Texas Blood or Southern Bastards or something like that might be something you'd actually quite enjoy reading. Because the if you've got an 8-year-old in your house and it's like, oh, I want to get my 8-year-old to read, the biggest thing you can do if you're a guy and it's your son is read in front of him.
Right.
Well, let's jump back in there. That was a really cool little part of a podcast there.
So well said.
Well said. That's Stu Coulson. He's from the Heroes for Sale comic store in Auckland, talking to Aro Singh on Kiwis and Comic Books, a podcast. And you can find these podcasts on YouTube.
Yeah.
We're almost out of time today, but we were going to have a chat about, you know, how cool a message that was.
It is, because really, if you don't read, we can find something that will fit your interests and tastes. We can do that. It's what we do for a living.
Mm. So maybe next time we'll jump in again, if we're doing this again, Andy, and we can have a chat. I was going to ask you how you got interested in reading, you know, based on this conversation, and just be interesting to know, but...
Oh,
that's something to think about anyway.
That's a big thought. Yeah.
You know, if we want our children to read, then modeling it, getting off our phones or screens or whatever is going to be the thing.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, read and show them that you like to read.
Yeah.
Yes.
Awesome. Hey, well, thanks for tuning in, everybody, and listening to The Shelf. We'll be back in 2 weeks with another episode.
Yeah. Yes, thank you, everyone, for listening.
And come and say hi. See us at the library sometime. Until then, have a good rest of your day.
Yeah. Ka kite.
Ka kite.